So today we're going to get a little bit motional. We're talking about motion. In other words, as a particle moves through space, what's happening with the motion of the particle? And things like, what is the velocity? And what is the acceleration? Answering these questions can help us understand how a particle behaves and where it might be going. So let's begin. So what do we have? We're going to have our position function, and we're going to think as everything in terms of vector-valued functions, because we want to do calculus, and we need to have things as vector-valued functions in order to do calculus. So we have our x, y, and z. And that gives us, at any time, our location, our position. Where are we? Well, next up, we look at r prime of t. And we talked about this before. And we use that to say, well, r prime of t, that gave us a direction of our tangent line. But what is r prime of t doing? Well, r prime of t is saying, how is position changing? We say, okay, well, if I want to know how my location or my position changes, there's a name for that, velocity. So r prime is velocity, and we use the symbol v, v of t for velocity. Now, there's something related, the magnitude of r prime of t, and that's speed. So what's the difference between speed and velocity? Because they're not quite the same. For one thing, speed is a number. Velocity is a vector. So that's a big clue that they're not the same. But what's being measured? Well, speed is just saying, what's the amount of change? If you like, the magnitude of the change. Whereas velocity says, look, I don't just need to know the amount of change, but I need to know in what direction the change is occurring. So velocity is storing more information. It's also saying, in what direction are things happening? Okay, now our last thing we want to talk about, the second derivative, r double prime of t. Well, of course, it's easy to take derivatives, right? You just take derivative of each entry. So x double prime, y double prime, z double prime, yeah. Now, what is this measuring? Well, it's the derivative of the derivative. So if the derivative was the velocity, now we say, well, look, the second derivative is how the first derivative changes, or how velocity changes. And this also has a name. This is called acceleration. And so we say, okay, give it a symbol, a. So a of t is acceleration. And now you're probably thinking, wow, a of t for acceleration, v of t for velocity, r of t for position? Well, it's just the convention. We learn to live with strange names. All right, so now we can talk about our generic things about motion. How are we going through space? Well, let's go back to our tangent line. Now, we know what our tangent line does. And so let's suppose we have our particle traveling through space, doing all sorts of strange and beautiful things. And so there's our particle flying around. If I look at a particular point here, then I could say, well, there's some information about what's happening. So in particular, we can look at the tangent line. So the tangent line was storing information about the position and the change in position. In other words, we're storing information about the direction of motion. Well, what if we wanted to also have some additional information? Say, the direction of acceleration. Now, it's often the case that the direction of motion, velocity, and the direction of acceleration are not going in the same way. Now, if they were going in the same way, what would it mean? It would mean you'd just be going faster and faster in one direction. You wouldn't be changing your direction. So whenever you see a turning curve, that says, look, acceleration's pulling it to turn. And so, say, well, that certainly looks like the case here. We see some turning action going on. So if we have our velocity, we're doing this. So here's our velocity at time t. Our acceleration looks like it's pulling it off to the side by some amount. Now, in some sense, the size of acceleration will also dictate how quickly you turn. You know, both the size and, of course, the direction. All right. So we say, all right, well, now I have two vectors and a point. And we say, well, great, we can make a plane. And so we make a plane. And we call this plane, it has a nice special name here. So this plane, this is called the osculating plane. Now, osculating, not a very common word. You don't often go say, hey, it's great to see you. Let's osculate later. But what does it really mean? Well, it turns out that osculate, one way to interpret it is to kiss. So what happens is this is the plane which is somehow kissing that curve at that point. But I like to think of it as it saying, look, as far as the curve goes, this is the interesting plane at that point because it contains location, direction of motion, velocity, and direction of acceleration. All the interesting behavior of what's happening at that point of time is being stored inside of this plane. All right, so the osculating plane, very easy. So if you ever are asked to say, hey, what's the osculating plane? Just think location, motion, acceleration. It has all of them. You're like, great, perfect. So not so bad. Now you might say, okay, I can go in some sense forward. That is, you give me position. All right, I can find velocity by taking derivative. I can find acceleration by taking two derivatives. Can I work back up? Well, yeah. If you think about it, the way we got from position to velocity to acceleration was taking derivatives. So now we're just going to do the opposite of taking derivatives. We call that antiderivatives, the opposite of derivatives. So we can say, take the derivative of acceleration, velocity. The antiderivative of acceleration, velocity. Antiderivative of velocity, position, and so forth, and so on. Now, how do we do antiderivatives for vector-valued functions? Well, think back to how we did derivatives. The way we do derivatives is entry by entry, one entry at a time. So the way we take antiderivatives is entry by entry, one entry at a time. Now, there is one small caveat, a thing to be aware of, that when you take an antiderivative, there's always a constant involved. So where does the constant show up? Well, it would not be the case that you would say, well, look, the integral of some function, we'll just make up a really simple one, t squared, it doesn't matter how many dimensions it has. You know, it can be 2 dimensions, 5 dimensions. Most of our time, we'll be spending it in 3 dimensions. After all, that's the one we're really comfortable with, 3 dimensions. Well, again, you really think of it, look, it's the antiderivative of each entry. And so what that means is, look, when you have your constants, you're going to have a constant for each individual entry. And they're different constants. So you would have something like 1/2 t² plus c and 1/3 t³ plus d. So in other words, put a constant in each individual entry. One thing we definitely would not do is throw in something like this. We would never, this is bad notation, if we would never write this as 1/2 t², comma 1/3 t³ plus a constant c. That just is out. It doesn't make any sense because vectors and numbers are different objects. They don't mix, so we can't add them together. Well, what we could do, and this is the other alternative, if you don't like thinking of putting a constant in each entry, you can say, well, we can add a constant vector. That's perfectly legal. And that's the same. You see, what happened is you just said, look, I'll pull off the constants, and now life is good. Life is great. So one last thing to talk about, which is a little bit of foreshadowing for things to come. It says, okay, let's suppose we have our position function, and we have 2 questions. Well, between t equals a and t equals b, how far has the particle moved? All right, well, in other words, I have here at time a, it does something, and it's over here at time b. How far has it moved? Well, the answer is, you look at the difference in locations. So we can think of it as r of b minus r of a. All right, that's pretty straightforward, right? just take the end minus the start. Because these are vectors, when you take a difference of two vectors, well, the result is the difference, how much you've changed. And in other words, how much we've moved and stored information about both the magnitude and direction of motion. So that's great, that's beautiful. Now, what's another way to compute this? Well, we could write this. It seems kind of strange to do it this way, but we could. So look, this is r of t evaluated from t equals a to t equals b. And, I mean, it's correct, right? You plug in b, subtract, plug in a. And this, okay, I claim, well, is the same as integrating r prime of t dt from a to b. So that's a way to compute how far the particle has moved. Let's think about the logic here. If we see what we have here, r prime of t is the velocity at time t. So this is, how am I changing at any particular time? Scale it by a small change in time. It says, here's a small bit of change. Add up all our small bits of change, and we get a total change. Okay, second question. Between time t equals a and t equals b, how far has the particle traveled? You see, when we initially said, well, look, we start here at a, we end here at b, we could be moving all sorts of ways. But at the end, we say, look, I only care about the start and the finish. We don't care about the journey in between. But there's certainly a difference between doing a journey that goes swoop, straight across versus one that's very meandering and takes a while to get there. So how do we figure this out? Well, what can we do? And the answer is, we'll get into this a lot in our next session, but we think about, all right, maybe we shouldn't be keeping track of velocity, because velocity says, hey, I keep track of location and direction. So I could have some increase going one way, but I'm canceling it out if I pull back. So look, we don't want to keep track of direction. So all we want is the magnitude. Ah, well, if all you want is the magnitude, that just says throw some magnitudes there. And what do we get? Well, integral a to b of magnitude r prime of t dt. So essentially, it's the difference between integrating velocity and integrating speed. And speed says, look, I'm not keeping track of, you know, which way are you going? I'm just saying, how far are you moving? And so that gives us our total distance that we've traveled. And that will be a wonderful topic for our next session. But for now, we should go do some practice with the problems that we've talked about. In other words, integrating, how do we integrate vector-valued functions? Spoiler alert, entry by entry. Talk about oscillating planes and do some applications. If we know acceleration, we know some initial information, can we find where we're at? Yeah, as long as we're careful. So let's go do some practice. See you soon.